I'd just like to say I have been in my business close to 30 years, well, 29 years now. So I've seen a lot of commercial presentations and a lot of marketing initiatives. And over time, you kind of learn to sort through things that are, as Tom indicated, just another marketing initiative. But I have to say, and Mole Valley's not paying me to be here, by the way, that this is an exciting one to me because I think it really hits at core issues of life cycle, the whole lifetime performance, profitability, putting economics with scientific principles or best practices. So I'm excited to be a part of this. I appreciate the chance to hear what you're doing and look forward to seeing how it develops over the years. So the forgotten months, I like that. I've never heard that before. That's really a good way to describe it. When I started way back when, I kind of gravitated towards things that other people weren't doing. And at that time, dry cows and transition was starting to be a popular topic, but the whole coupling that back to the early dry period, nobody was doing that. The calf area is certainly an area that I felt was ignored or given too little importance. We think of a calf as something that got fed a bag of milk replacer, you know, and that's the science of what was being brought to it. So that was an area that I got into kind of by accident, and it's been a great area to work in. The heifers is probably the remaining area of the forgotten months, and I have not personally done a lot of research or work in that area, but over the years come to understand the importance and hopefully can bring you a few thoughts today about things that we are forgetting and going forward working with Mole Valley and others in the industry that will be able to make some differences. So obviously the heifer enterprise is a huge component of the dairy, total dairy enterprise. We need to have those quality replacements. It's truly a life cycle, that the enterprise is a living organism, and we have to have the new replacements. We need, typically figured that we need about 85% of the milking herd as replacement animals. And that's, again, a widely variable number based on individual farm situations. But it's affected by things like pregnancy rates and calving intervals and longevity. And so there are goals that can be set and progress made in this part of the enterprise. Not only for profitability of the next generation, but it's a major cost center. We all know that. And too often, I think that's only what we think about. It's a cost. You saw that line in the calculator model that, you know, you're going negative on lifetime profitability for a couple of years. And so that's a challenge. It's the second biggest cost center of the milk of the farm next to the feed for the milking herd. You know, and on a 600 cow farm in our country, raising their own heifers, it's $750,000 a year. And that's some significant change. And so it is an important enterprise to look at. The ideas of sustainability that are a part of this lifetime profitability, lifetime program, were highlighted in the conference that we attended in Madrid the last couple of days. The idea of sustainability in the dairy industry. Now, that's a fuzzy term, and that was a point of a lot of discussion about what that really means. But I think you can see here today that what it means as part of a dairy farm or a dairy industry, in terms of heifers, it's an economic part. That's always my number one answer when somebody wants to talk about sustainability, what that means. If you can't continue to be profitable in your business, there is no business. There will be no business. And the UK will import their dairy products from, I don't know, Ireland or New Zealand. And I don't think that's what any of us want. So economic sustainability is number one in my book. And that means that we have to continue to try to find ways to be more profitable in a hugely difficult market and business to be in. So optimizing costs. I'm not going to say reduce costs. Because that's one of my messages, is we have to get away from thinking of everything, particularly in this area, as just a cost. It's an investment. Your heifers are an investment. And it's a longer-term investment. It doesn't mature in a year, unfortunately. But it is an area where we can look for some lower-cost alternatives. We can use roughages, forages that are not the highest quality milking forages, for as one example. And we shouldn't be afraid to spend a little money on heifers for things that will produce a better animal and contribute to the overall profitability of the farm. Environmental issues, increasingly more important, already much more important here than in many parts of the U.S. It's certainly a source of non-productive nitrogen and phosphorus and whatever other nutrients you want to talk about. Part of the farm load, and yet it's coming from animals that, again, are not contributing immediate income. We also have a tension, particularly in the area of protein or nitrogen nutrition, between making sure that we're continuing to allow growth in the heifers, which takes protein, takes nitrogen, and minimizing the loss of that nutrient into the environment. So it's very easy on grass-based systems, for example, to lose a huge amount of the total nitrogen that's called protein entering the animal. And we don't capture all that non-protein nitrogen or soluble protein in grass. So there's a real competition, a real tension, and I think an area of potential improvement in raising heifers by trying to improve nitrogen management or nitrogen retention in the animal. We're facing a difficult social environment increasingly as our consumers know less and less about agriculture and farming and care more and more about where food comes from. So there's a number of social issues that are affected and heifers contribute to or offer opportunities. It's another place where labor is required every day. And again, it's not the most exciting. It's not everybody's number one priority. Maybe not even number two or three, but it's an important area. So it's a challenge to the social fabric of families and individuals that are working on the farm. From the other side, it's also a challenge or a potential area of challenge to the consumers. Think about things that wouldn't look good to a London resident that comes to your farm or your neighbor's farm, right? A lot of people get really upset about the idea of isolating calves or having calves even in individual pens next to each other. My own wife gets me static about that. We know why we do it, but does the consumer? Why do we take calves away from mother, by the way? Right, all these things that are hard to understand for people that have no background. Coming onto the farm and seeing a dead calf lying by the side of the barn, waiting to be picked up, or a pile of dead calves, which probably a lot of you have seen in certain areas. Seeing a bunch of heifers out in a muddy pasture in mud up to their knees in a cold rain. That doesn't look very good to the average consumer that doesn't know agriculture. So there's lots of things that we get by with, we let go because we have to or because we really don't give it a high enough priority. So those are challenges. It's a huge part of business growth and improvement. It fits into the lifetime model very well. Now, what are you going to do in the future to improve that situation? How will you increase herd size? How will you increase herd quality? Your productivity, profitability? Are you going to increase cattle sales? You know, there's opportunities. If we're doing a better job on heifer management and rearing, we have more heifers to sell and sell for dairy purposes rather than to slaughter. So just kind of some philosophy here to begin. Heifer rearing is expensive. This is a summary in the Midwestern part of the U.S. Put out in 2014, so it's not really current. I would say the average cost now is probably a little bit lower than this. This was a high price time, but you get the idea. I saw the numbers. It was 1,600 pounds or something on Tom's slides, and that's pretty close to this. Feed, major component of that. So this is $2.37 per heifer per day, a little bit more if you include labor. And again, it's more costly early on. So the pre-weaned heifers are more expensive per day than older heifers. But again, we have to really, that's an area we have to think of as an investment. One of my pet peeves to try to move away from the daily cost. On Wisconsin farms, at about the same time, they looked at daily costs. And I just want to point out that heifer growing operations, so businesses dedicated to taking calves or heifers at a certain age and returning them to the client, significantly lower cost per day. Well, that's their business, right? And so the more money, the more inexpensively they can do the job and return a quality product to the client farms, that's how they make their living. So there are ways that people that are paying attention to the business can decrease the cost of heifer production. So to put some general principles that I think carry on nicely from Jessica's talk all the way through to the next calving, we want to capitalize on that early growth potential. We'll get into that a little bit more, but calves and young heifers have a huge potential to grow very rapidly that we just have not taken advantage of. The most efficient period of the animal lifetime in terms of growth. Increasing efficiency. Yeah, every expert comes and talks to you about becoming more efficient, right? And there seems like there's got to be a limit. But we have continuous improvement, and there are things that deal with biological efficiency for the animals. So we can improve the gain to feed ratio. We can decrease days to puberty and conception and age at first calving. Those are biological changes within the management system. And lifetime production, all the things that are being talked about here today. And then within the system, within the farm or the heifer enterprise, there are also efficiencies to be gained. Focusing on decreasing the wastes in the system, the losses in the system. Every time we have a calf die or a heifer die, that's a loss of efficiency in the system, right? And there's a lot we can do to control that. Making the system more uniform by paying attention to these practices. So we have greater uniformity and less variation in size and performance of heifers of different ages. Decreasing the impacts of disease, as I said, a death loss, illness that causes temporary loss of growth performance, or ones like pneumonia, respiratory disease early on that cause permanent loss of performance. That's a waste in the system. That's a leakage in the system if we have a lot of pneumonia because those calves are damaged forever. I have I'll come to that in a minute. Optimizing resources per heifer calved into the herd. So concentrating investment on places that we can make the most impact. Genomic selection. I don't know how common that is becoming here in the UK, but the opportunity to say at a week of age or sometime very early, I don't think I want this heifer to calve into my herd. Wow. You know, at 7 days of age instead of 10 months after she calved and you realize she's a dog. Right? Huge opportunity to improve efficiency in the system. Raise fewer calves. Raise the best ones. Wow. That's for an old farm boy like me, excites me. All these improvements here, we've concentrating resources into the heifers that are actually going to be milked in our herd, get rid of the rest. That's a gain in the system as a whole. All right, well, Jessica talked about this. This is pretty easy. When is the most efficient time? We think of growth as basically a linear function. She gave the example of what it takes in terms of growth rate from birth to calving to get to a certain size. By chance, my number comes up almost exactly the same. 800 grams a day from birth to first calving. That's hard to do if you let them stall out for a month or two early on or at any point in the whole system. The most efficient time, as Jessica talked about, is early in life. As soon as that calf hits the ground, she's ready to grow, and you saw that in some of her numbers. And so if we look at this chart, this is the percentage change from the previous 2 months in the open bars here for the percentage body weight increase over the last two-month period. So you can see that that number is very high, the highest in this chart for the first 2 months of life, and then that percentage change decreases as we're getting closer to mature size. You can look at it on a cost basis. The black bars are the cost, feed cost per kilogram body weight gain. Okay? It's lowest early in life because we're making the greatest relative changes. We may think we're putting more money per day into the animals, but we're getting more out of it. The more we put in, the more we get out in that very early life period. That's a huge opportunity, and we've never taken advantage of that. We can look at on a frame size basis. If you don't like body weight, it's the same message here. If you look at the cost per centimeter of height increase, this is Withers height, very low early in life because that calf is you know, growing tremendously on a relative basis, and it becomes very expensive once we get basically the close to the maturation of the skeletal size at puberty. So we should be taking advantage of that early on. And certainly early growth from calf, from birth on into the first few heifer growths groups is a very rich opportunity for improvement. Well, again, out of that total cost, we also have money that's spent on health costs, veterinary, medical, sickness treatments, and so on, a significant component, particularly early in life. Once we get to the post-weaned heifer, we have relatively low death losses. USDA National Animal Health Monitoring System surveys that are conducted periodically in the U.S. Show that that's typically less than 2% of heifers born alive, the loss between weaning and calving. So not death is not a big issue. But respiratory disease accounts for about half of those. It's the biggest single cause. So again, we come back to respiratory disease. I think this is a huge problem. And again, I'm not a veterinarian, but in working with a lot of vets in the U.S., a lot of good vets that I really respect for their knowledge and management capabilities, really concerned about respiratory. On many farms, they find that it's underdiagnosed and probably a bigger contributor to long-term problems than the farm ever realizes. And again, it's not so much the mortality, although early on it can be a significant factor. But as I said before, those heifers are damaged permanently. One vet I know that in the Midwest that I've worked with some puts ear notches in every time he treats a calf or diagnoses a calf for respiratory. Puts a little notch, one case of respiratory. Second case gets another notch, and he tells the farmer, you should sell that calf right now. Farm can do what they want, but if he comes back and puts a third notch in, he said, you know, I'm not even talking to you anymore. Because the cumulative effects are very severe, and those animals will never have the capacity to become a productive dairy cow. And they'll probably be a cow that, if they do survive into lactations, that someday they'll keel over. They'll die, more than likely. But again, number of studies have shown the long-term effects, the cumulative effects of respiratory disease on lost performance, both during the growth period and then on into lactation. Certainly a major detractor from lifetime profitability. So work with your veterinarian on, you know, how to control those situations. I want to just mention this because this is something that I've learned just within the last year, and to me it seems very important. So frequently we will see calves a week or two or a month after weaning with this very runny diarrhea, right? And of course, like most things, it's a nutritionist's problem. It's got to be something wrong with the nutrition program. So we try to add a little bit more forage. We take away a little bit of forage. We say it's, you know, the concentrate is too rich. There's always an excuse. And it's hard to correct by manipulating anything in the diet. So we get calves, and I'll blow this up here a little bit, that are dirty in the back end. They've got dirty tails, dirty hindquarters, maybe a little rough hair coat. Do you see that here? Yeah? It's been a very frustrating thing. working with a very talented guy that I've come to know in the U.S., we think we've identified really a reason that's, in some ways it's not surprising, but to me it's very surprising. So you find Giardia in that, you can culture Giardia out of that runny manure. You know what Giardia is? It's a parasite, and it's often found in water. So if you go camping in the hills and drink the water out of the stream, you might get Giardia, and it's not a pleasant experience, I understand. I've never had it. Very painful, severe diarrhea, okay? Yeah, but Giardia is everywhere in the soil, and it's a very commonly found parasite around the world. And I didn't look it up for the UK, but I'd be willing to bet it's here too. So a simple deworming treatment with the preferred one that we have is fenbendazole. I don't know for sure if you have that, but just a single weaning treatment or post-weaning treatment about a week after the calves come together in a group, it goes away. You know, I don't know your weaning products, your weaning protocols. Certainly people that are grazing have greater emphasis on deworming protocols than a lot of us confinement guys, but anyway, we find out new things that are old things all the time. So, you know, we're having farmers do a weaning treatment in situations where they've never done one at that age and seeing some real benefit in that. Continuous learning, I guess. All right, so feed is over half the cost of the total cost of rearing heifers. So obviously the nutrition component of heifers is big. It's very important. So we start with colostrum. It was mentioned this morning, not really discussed. We've heard the story of colostrum a lot, but it doesn't get any less important. And I think just one thing I'll add to the general knowledge, we all know about getting colostrum into the calves soon after birth, getting enough in, measuring quality and so on. But in the last 10 to 15 years, the biggest breakthrough, I think, in terms of colostrum management has been the appreciation for how easily colostrum is contaminated with bacteria after birth. And so we end up doing the other things well. We're very quickly getting a large amount of colostrum with an enormous soup of manure in it, right? So somebody may be doing a very good job in getting the cow milked, getting it fed to the calf quickly, and still having problems with passive transfer, or with disease, early disease problems. And in many cases, that can be traced to a breakdown in sanitation or hygiene. You think about every step of that process, from cleaning the cow's udder and having a clean milking machine, to the pail that colostrum goes into, to the bottle or to the esophageal feeder. Everything has to be kept scrupulously clean after every use, okay? It's a piece of a milking equipment. You know, you don't leave your parlor unwashed for a week and then decide maybe you should scrub it out, right? Every use, and that's often a problem. But it's remarkable how quickly the contamination can occur at any one of those steps, and then we're ended up feeding bacteria to the calves. End of sermon. So from the colostrum, we go to milk powder or whole milk. Very nice discussion earlier today about that. We have to be introducing the concentrate feeds, the starter concentrates, get them on a full feed of that, along with small amounts of forage. But eventually, we're working towards turning that animal into a forage burner. So we have to be thinking about that goal of turning it into a forage using the animal. So controlling feed costs, again, thinking back to these principles, trying to optimize the resources the farm has or minimize the investment in a suitable outcome. So the lowest cost feeds available or forages available that still are providing what the animal needs. I didn't say the lowest cost forage, right? There's some that just should not be fed. I don't know what you do with that. Find a neighbor to buy it or something. Capitalize again in that early growth potential. We talked about that. Increasing the efficiencies, decreasing impacts of loss. Those all have an impact on feed cost per something. Feed cost per heifer, feed cost per kilogram of weight gain, or feed cost per day in most cases. But I think we need to start thinking about, in case of Jessica's presentation and on through the heifer program, I preach this a lot to people. We have to be moving away from just thinking of it as a cost per day, because that's no business, no other business would just look at their profitability or their productivity and say, well, I spent $10,000 on steel today. So what? You know, what did you produce with the steel? So I spent twice as much on milk replacer today. Well, I got almost twice as much body weight gain, okay? Feed cost per kilogram of gain. Cost per day of life until the heifer enters the milking string. That's one I've not seen used very much, but I'd like somebody to explore that. You know, again, we're trying to decrease the cost of bringing an excellent replacement heifer into the herd. You have to spend money to make money. My dad told me that. He didn't have any money, but he said if you had money, you know, you got to spend to make more. And again, away from cost, but over to think of it as an investment. I know that's difficult when you're paying bills every day. So moving into the post-weaning nutritional considerations, it's really a lot of the same things that were talked about this morning. Two main factors: we have to have adequate metabolizable protein. We have to continue to provide that protein to make the animal grow. We're still building skeleton. Bone is made of protein, actually. We think of it being made of minerals, but there's a protein matrix that we fill with calcium and phosphorus. So protein has to be adequate to continue to fuel that rapid growth. And to do that, we need to be thinking about one of the models that predicts metabolizable protein. So that's different than crude protein, right? We predict what actually is converted into the bacterial protein in the rumen, as well as what's going to bypass the rumen. And that's different from crude protein. Again, you can have 26% protein in your grass, and maybe 10% of that is usable to the animal, because a lot of it's soluble and just gets peed out and contributes to our environmental problems. So we have to match that with an appropriate amount of energy. We may have to limit energy for those of us in the maize silage world, where farms are increasingly reliant on maize silage as the primary forage. We've got to think about how do we limit these heifers in energy intake, or they get too fat. Big problem. Maximizing protein supply to the animal while matching that with the appropriate energy supply. If we're dealing with lower quality grass as the only forage, then we're usually thinking about supplementing some energy with a little bit of maize grain or some other concentrates. Grouping, we talked a little bit about that this morning. I really like the more recent research with pairing or grouping baby calves, but if they're housed individually, we start them off in small groups at some point. It's always been recommended a small group, so the ease of social adaptation is less stressful, and then they become able to live in larger groups as they get older. Ration principles are pretty simple. That's the implementation that's often challenging. Once those heifers are weaned, we still have to remember they need concentrates. So even though we start to rely a little bit more on forage, they still need to be primarily concentrate driven at that young age. They're still growing rapidly. Their forage digestion ability is still not mature, and their total rumen capacity is not sufficient for them to really survive on forage alone. We can introduce grass silages or corn silages in this early period, as long as we're remembering again that we need to have adequate concentrate supplementation. Many farms have taken the milker TMR and used that as the first kind of forage base. I would typically recommend that in a ratio of about 4 or 5 parts dry matter from the starter grower concentrate to 1 part of the dry matter from that TMR, just so that we're not getting too heavily into the fiber, into the forage fiber too early. All heifers need vitamins and minerals. How we get that in is one of the management choices, I guess. If we're providing, it's best to force feed that somehow if you have a concentrate mix or a pseudo TMR, so that we ensure the heifers get that. If they're on pasture, we may want to use a small amount of concentrate or free choice minerals, less desirable choice, but we have to make it worse. All heifers need water every day and clean water. And again, if we have cold or mud situations where those animals are out in the environment, it's going to increase the energy requirements. So we have to remember that it's going to take them a little bit more just to keep warm and keep their body temperature at a constant amount relative to a sheltered animal. Guidelines, and again, I don't like to put up slides like this because people take numbers and not the message. So you need to work with a nutritionist to have these numbers for your farm. But the principles being here that obviously dry matter intake is going to increase as the heifer gets larger. We need to balance for a middle range of some group of heifers that we have. The protein starts off fairly high in the younger heifers, and I think for the even smaller than this, that protein is perhaps higher than that, particularly coming off of high milk programs. But that will decrease over time. We can use more as rumen-degraded protein, or whatever your term is, protein that's available in the rumen to grow the bacteria as the heifers get older. As long as we're thinking about the end point of metabolizable protein output. And the energy density required decreases as well as the heifers get larger. Now here's a simple grouping strategy. And again, there's for 100 farms, there's 200 different ways of doing things on the particular farms. But this is a relatively simple scheme that breaks heifers into a couple of smaller age ranges here early on. Again, to reduce competition, focus more specifically on the individuals at that age with ration one, which I'll show you in a minute. Going to 6 to 9 months and then up to 9 to 12 months for the kind of the pre-breeding groups can be a little bit larger, maybe a little bit different or larger age spread. And the ration can be cheaper or different at that age. Then the breeding group and the pregnant heifers, again, probably can be fed a third diet. And then the last group before calving would go into the dry cow management programs in some way. So again, three rations here fed over six different groups, actually. So you can see, again, the general principles. We're decreasing in protein provided in those groups as we get older. Less undegraded protein, more rumen-available protein, and we're decreasing the energy density that we're having in your units, finally, of those heifers as they grow larger. So principles are very simple. Again, we're going to control the silage and pasture for that very youngest group or two groups after weaning. Those groups need grain yet and a protein supplement. We talked about the lactation TMR. We still may need grain supplementation in groups 3 and 4, those middle sizes up to breeding. Those heifers still, we're trying to ensure the metabolizable protein so they continue to grow the frame. We need more vitamins and minerals, particularly minerals at that time to fuel that growth. And then by the time we get to groups 5 and 6, the older heifers, maybe we don't need concentrate anymore. But again, that's very much dependent on what the forage base is and how we're going to manage that. A number of areas for optimizing feed costs. And this is just a list that appeared in a dairy magazine. Again, developing a ration based on the needs of the heifers for that age. You can't just, you know, have one bin that has heifer feed that goes from 3 months to calving. It really doesn't get the job done. We don't want to overfeed those more expensive ingredients. So again, optimizing the ration so that we are providing the requirements without wasting. And we see a lot of excessive vitamin and mineral supplementation in all of our cattle, to be honest. So that's an area that can be monitored closely. Monitoring the feeding, you know, if we throw out the concentrate in the mud, the feed efficiency goes down. So just the feeding systems and strategies, forage costs, always an issue. Knowing what we're feeding in the forage Those forages should be analyzed just like we do for the lactating cows. Grazing, that doesn't really apply here. There's more grazing expertise here than in the entire US. Feeding high quality and palatable concentrates to the younger heifers again. Monitoring, measuring, knowing what the calves are doing, the heifers are doing. Having some relatively easy benchmarking system, whether it's a height on a fence post at breeding size, so we know that they're big enough. Some way to monitor our success and to be able to assess the variation from that goal within a pen of heifers. We want to, again, focus on all these groups of keeping the heifers growing. Remember, 800 grams a day. Doesn't do any good for Jessica's program to give us 900 at, you know, by the end of the weaning period if we have the six-month-old heifers that are not gaining any weight. And it's interesting to go on larger farms where you have a lot of heifer groups, and you, as you walk by the pens, it's easy to pick out where the system's breaking down, right? Beautiful calves, nice heifers. Okay, heifers, you know, there's one group where things start to fall apart. They start to get fat, they look rough, and so monitoring that each age of calves and keeping them growing steadily and considering the environment. All right, so one of the topics that often gets asked is, what's the best age at first calving? I hate this argument, okay? But I think I have I have something for you to think about to address that issue. If you look at the scientific literature, and this is just a selection of papers that have been published, there's results all over the range of possible values. And you can see a number of studies from different countries here, and you get different answers. Part of that is they may be different systems, and that, you know, you have to take that into account. But it's not very helpful on an individual farm basis. So let me show you this. It'll take me a bit to explain this. This is a study from University of Wisconsin, and they looked at a huge database of farm data and looked at, so what I've got here plotted is the age at first calving in months, so from 30 months down to 20 on the x-axis here, versus lifetime milk production, okay? Lifetime milk in kilos. What the researchers did then, after they had this database, was to try to categorize it into some groups based on, they were trying to get it based on management ability or management goals. And that's hard to quantify, right? So what they did as a proxy of that idea is to break down the farms into four groups. The bottom line down here is herds that milk twice a day and had the lowest average herd milk production, rolling herd averages of milk production. The top line is herds that were milking three times a day and had the highest milk production averages per herd. Okay? So the idea is you think, well, the management goal, the management is different. The management is more intensive on the highest group, whether that's because, yeah, you're comfortable where you are, or maybe you're just not that good. You fit into this group down here. Okay? It's a crude measurement, but I think it points out some things. The middle two groups here are 3x milking and the middle herd production, and 2x milking with middle herd production. Okay? You can argue about the criteria, but I think it divides it into some interesting groupings here. So, with those groups, look at the shape of the relationships and the trends of those relationships. The lowest group here, lowest average milk production per herd and twice daily milking, you can see there's a curvilinear here, curvilinear response, where the greatest lifetime production happens when the heifers calve somewhere between 23, 24 months up to maybe 25, or you can see the lines better than I can from this angle. Okay, so that's kind of standard recommendations. 2X milkers with higher average milk production, the same shape. You see there's an optimum, but perhaps a little bit younger, maybe a month or two younger. The higher, the three times milking herds, more intensive management, there's no curvilinear anymore, right? Across this range of thousands of animals and the range of ages at first calving, there's no loss of milk production at younger ages. In fact, that's where the highest total lifetime milk is in those herds. Okay? Interesting, isn't it? So what that says is a couple of things. People that want to calve earlier can do it, and the heifers are no less productive. In fact, over the lifetime, they may be more productive. People that don't want to calve heifers that early, or try it and calve undergrown, overfat heifers, don't do very well at that younger age. Okay? I think it's pretty simple. So I think that the results, and then if you look at individual studies, where heifers are well grown, where they've reached that adequate size at first calving, and management of all phases is good, they do fine. All right? Heifers that are not grown appropriately shouldn't calve before they're at an adequate size. So I think the optimal average daily gain is very much farm specific. And that's a good cop-out for a good dodge for somebody like me. But I think it is, because you have to commit to a system to make it work. And some people aren't going to do it. Some people can't do it for whatever reason. But I think that average daily gains of 800 grams a day over the life of the heifer are I hate to say easy, but they're achievable by just following good management principles and the advice of your good friends at Mole Valley. We can go higher than that. We can go to 900 grams per day and calve earlier. Individual studies, even higher rates of growth than that. But again, it's making sure that the animals are getting consistent, high supply of protein and controlling the energy intake. A fat heifer is not a good heifer, and we see that so much in my country. It's getting better, but it's been a problem. So Jessica mentioned this morning. This is a very useful concept or approach to knowing where your heifer should be at different stages of growth, and it's called the target growth rate concept, and it really is linking management to the actual biology or the growth principles of the animals. So we need to know the mature body weight. And this is a good thing also that makes it herd specific. Not all Holsteins are alike. They're close enough in some cases. But we have different areas of the world have different mature sizes. Canadian Holsteins are bigger than Holsteins in Florida. We know there's a photoperiod effect. There's all kinds of things that can impact that. Interesting, a big study of feed efficiency that's been completed recently in the U.S. with several thousand cows. I think the average weight of mature Holstein cows in the U.S. is 720 kilograms, greater than third lactation cows at energy balance. So a little bit bigger than I think some of us have used. Regardless, measure the third and greater lactation cows in your herd when they're at energy balance and making milk. That's your mature body size, okay? So you can make it farm specific. We know that puberty occurs at a percentage of mature body size, a particular body weight or body size relative or rather than age. So Jessica said that before, 45% of mature body weight. We should have animals pregnant by 55% of their mature body weight. Heifers should calve 85% of their mature body weight. So again, if you have a certain goal age at first calving, we can set that, and then the math is pretty easy to calculate what we need to do at those intermediate points? What are our targets at certain growth rates? This is also, it makes things independent of changes with time in a breed or on your farm, as long as you update it every once in a while. This was a study that has done at the University of Minnesota where they've kept a line of cattle that were selected or at 1960s genetics. So they continue to breed with these old bulls over time, and then a selected line. And there's several thousand, 3,600 kilos difference between those two groups in 1990, and that, you know, we're well beyond that at this point. So the heifers, Holstein heifers, have gotten bigger over time. You can see the controls, old style controls here versus the selected individuals. They're heavier and taller. So, you know, there are changes over time. Maybe we're moving away from that a little bit now with selection goals. But this principle makes it independent of all that noise, and independent of whether you have Jerseys or Holsteins or Montbéliard crosses or something else. All right, so again, there's targets, physiological targets. Regardless of the mature body weight of your cows, you can set those targets. If I have 600 kilogram Holsteins, my heifers should be pregnant by 330 kilograms. Okay, 55% of their mature body weight. Okay, and the same thing by second and third calf, they're approaching their mature body size. So then we can set the growth targets for the individual groups. We know that, okay, I need them to grow to this size by 12 months of age, and we can formulate diets to satisfy that. So this introduces another common problem or places where we miss the target. So this was an example, 225 kilogram Holstein heifers, a target growth rate of 900 grams per day. So kind of an aggressive goal in this farm. Here was the ration, so alfalfa, lucerne, silage, maize silage, some roasted soy, a little bit of high moisture maize grain, so on. So they formulated this ration, and the amount of dry matter that this was based on, dry matter intake, was 5.7 kilos a day. That's what the nutritionist put in, and the model said that they were going to eat. Well, actually, given the forage quality, those heifers could eat much more, and if you offer it to them free choice, they will eat much more. So in this case, they could consume 6.6 kilos of that ration. Well, what's going to happen? They're going to get fat, right? You're missing the target. So we can manage that by one of a couple ways. Some people have gone to limit feeding heifers. I don't know how common that is at all in the UK, good. Some people make it work, but it's difficult. And I'm still not convinced of the long-term effects of limit feeding. And it is a bit challenging to make work. The other way is just change the ration. You gotta do something. Take out a little bit of the good quality silages, put some dry hay or some straw in. Something to reduce the energy density. They don't eat as much, there's not as much energy. You can match that with the protein, and they don't get fat. So it points out some of the challenges here of what are relatively simple principles, but actually translating that into groups that are successful is not as easy as it sounds. And I think that's why we have so many difficulties with the heifers that don't do as well as we should. Okay, so body composition, that I've mentioned fatness several times. Part of it is, I think, you understand that fat heifers, fat cows, don't do well. That's part of it. If we deposit fat early in the heifers, I showed you this morning the effects of overfeeding with the internal body fat that we can't really see. That starts to accumulate as heifers if we're overfeeding, and it usually never goes away, and it gets worse with every lactation. So we don't want fat heifers. But here's another way to look at that. If we have two 550 kilogram heifers approaching calving, are they always the same, right? We think we have these growth charts, which I don't like, but it says every Holstein cow, every Holstein heifer is the same. You have a line, it should be here, it should be within this range. Yeah. You know, averages are I guess what we have to work with. But if we have two heifers at 550 kilograms measured weight, and one is a body condition score 3 and the other body condition score is 4, are they the same? Should they be considered the same on a growth chart? This is part of where we get audience participation. Okay. No, right? So if you think about the relationship of a body condition score unit represents about 45 to 68 kilos of body weight. So this 550 kilogram heifer that is fatter is actually a smaller heifer, right? Frame size, that animal is probably not quite as big. She's the same weight, but she's only the same weight because she's got 50 kilos more fat, okay? And so the heifer, the 550 kilogram fatter heifer actually has a lower maintenance requirement because she has less frame size, less muscle mass to maintain. And so if you feed them the same, this one continues to get fatter because she's getting more relative to her actual working body mass. And so we have a lot of examples of this where variation in pens takes away some of our good intentions, that we're treating them all the same. We have to do that in group feeding situations. But if we get, when poor performance starts to occur in any one group, then it continues to carry on into subsequent groups. So heifer programs that have room for improvement, one of their characteristics is if we look at the variation in the group, it's tremendous. So if we put a desired performance and then say our tolerance is going to be plus or minus 10% or plus or minus one standard deviation, you can set control points that your animals should fall within that range. Well, there's only 41% in this example that fall within that desired performance. So we have variation at any time point. Here it looks like we're actually, for some reason, we're getting heifers too heavy for a point of time, and then they're all over the place by the time we get to calving age. Here's a better example. Now, these are pretty tight groups. So we don't see the extreme variation in within a size range. And that's really what we'd like to see. Is this farm satisfied? I don't know. Could they improve? Probably. There's always room for improvement. But certainly we have pretty wide ranges across farms. So I'm just going to close here, and I want to kind of go back to where we started. We have to think of our farm as a system. And we tend to, as I said earlier, we tend to isolate parts of it into individual components. We've got calves, and mom or George takes care of the calves. And then over here, we've got the lactating herd, and that's where the money is coming from. And then I guess we should feed the dry cows today. And you know, the heifers are, where are the heifers? So we need to think of all these parts as a system. And that's why I love this lifetime concept. Setting goals and targets for each part of the system, but knowing that they're interconnected. I love Jessica's comment this morning that you do a great job on the calves, implementing all these good feeding processes, and then you don't breed them until they're 15, 18 months of age. What happens during that time point? They just continue to get fatter because they're almost fully grown. They're just going to get fat. So thinking about how all these parts fit together into a system. Management, measuring, recording, monitoring, adjusting, assessing constantly. Evaluating past performance and updating your goals. You know, you get better, that's great. Where do you want to go now? And being an old farm boy or person dealing with farm operators all my life, it has to still be simple, right? You can design the most complex program in the world as an academic, and it'll never work on the farm. We know that. So it doesn't have to be complicated, but it has to be managed. And that's my final point. So thank you very much for your invitation to come here, and I wish you all success in this new program. I'm excited about it.